Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 9, Text Number 1. Parigraho hi dukkhaya yadyat priyatamam nrinam anantam sukamapnoti tadvidvan yastvachakrinaha tadvidvan yastvakinchanaha Shri Brahmana uvacha parigraho hi dukkhaya yadyat priyatamam nrinam anantam sukam apnoti tadvidvan yastvakinchanaha Shri Brahmana uvacha parigraho hi dukkhaya yadyat priyatamam nrinam anantam sukam apnoti tadvidvan yastvakinchanaha Shri Brahmana uvacha yadyat priyatamam nrinam anantam sukam apnoti tadvidvan yastvakinchanaha Shri Brahmana uvacha parigraho hi dukkhaya yadyat priyatamam nrinam anantam sukam apnoti tadvidvan yastvakinchanaha Shri Brahmana uvacha parigraho hi dukkhaya anantam sukam apnoti tadvidvan yastvakinchanaha Matajis Shri Brahmana uvacha parigraho hi dukkhaya yat yat priyatamam nrinam Hare Krishna Shri Brahmana uvacha, the saintly Brahmana said, Parigraha, attachment to possession, he certainly, dukkhaya, leading to misery, yat yat, whatever, priyatamam, is most dear, nanam, of men, anantam, unlimited, sukham, happiness, apnoti, achieves, tat, that, vidwan, knowing, yaha, whoever, tu, indeed, akinchanaha, is free from such attachment. Translation, the saintly Brahmana said, everyone considers certain things within the material world to be most dear to him. And because of attachment to such things, one eventually becomes miserable. One who understands this gives up material possessiveness and attachment and thus achieves unlimited happiness. There's no purport. So we'll also read the next verse. Samisham kururam jagnur balino nye niramishah tadamisham parityajya sasukham samavindhata. Translation: once a group of large hawks who were unable to find any prey attacked another weaker hawk who was holding some meat. At that time, being in danger of his life, the hawk gave up his meat and experienced actual happiness. Purport: incited by the modes of nature, birds become violent and kill other birds to eat them or to steal meat captured by them. Hawks, vultures, and eagles are in this category. However, one should give up the envious propensity to commit violence against others and should take to Krishna consciousness, whereby one sees every living entity as equal to oneself. On this platform of actual happiness, one does not envy anyone and thus sees no one as his enemy.
Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakhaya Chakshurum Nilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahyam Tadhati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Jutapadakamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhamvitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhano Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhyevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare.
Material desire is undoubtedly the saintly Brahmana said, everyone considers certain things within the material world to be most dear to him. And because of attachment to such things, one eventually becomes miserable. One who understands this gives up material possessiveness and attachment and thus achieves unlimited happiness. Once a group of large hawks who were unable to find any prey attacked another weaker hawk who was holding some meat. At that time, being in danger of his life, the hawk gave up his meat and experienced actual happiness. So Brahmana is explaining an important concept of how one prepares his life. In this life, one prepares to part with things, and illustrating that through the example of a hawk. So there was a weaker hawk holding some meat, and there was a large group of hawks who found this hawk to be an impediment. Why? Because this hawk was holding on to meat, the others were not able to procure any meat, so they attacked. This hawk, out of fear, sensing danger to his life, gave up the meat and experienced actual happiness because he saved his life, his own life. What can be greater happiness in this world than saving your life? And in the purport, it's explained that, or it's hinted rather, that there can be different grades, different shades of giving up things. One can give up out of fear, But one can also give up out of transcendental affection, happiness, out of concern. And we have several examples to show us guidance in all these respects. In the Smritis, often policy is divided into four. Sama, Dana, Danda, Bheda. Just like Krishna, before the battle of Kurukshetra began, tried every possible means to avoid the war. First, Sama tried and explained to Duryodhan how it is in his own interest. In fact, Krishna explained, and there's a history of so many sages explaining to Duryodhan, but Duryodhan simply couldn't, none of this that could register in his mind. Sama. So the next alternative is Dan. Now Dan has different connotations in different contexts. So here, as a policy, Dan is give something to appease. And Krishna went to the extent of offering, you take everything away, you take the entire Indraprastha away, just offer 5 villages back to Pandavas, nothing doing. That was Duryodhan's conclusion. And there is, of course, what remains? Danda and Bheda. But Krishna tried all possible means to even weaken the army of the Kauravas. It's beautifully explained in the Mahabharata how he even proposed to Karna, why don't you fight from the side of the Pandavas? In fact, even during the war, when Karna decided I will not fight under Bhishma, Krishna told Bhishma, theek hai, till the time you don't fight from the side of the Kauravas, why don't you fight from the side of the Pandavas? That's how flexible Krishna was. And of course, if nothing else remains, war, going at war. So we see this world also, there are different, in fact, there's a Puran called the Matsya Puran, in which there's an entire chapter dedicated to how, of all these, if we can resort to Sam, explanation and Dan, it's really preferred. Now the concept of Dan, though it is used in this context, from the point of view of appeasing someone, Dan as a part of one's life, one's lifestyle, is a lot more overbearing. Dan is not just about appeasing, but actually about cultivating the habit of parting with things, cultivating the habit of giving things away and feeling grateful about giving things away. I'll try and discuss in two parts. The first part, let's set a benchmark for ourselves. Benchmarks that we have seen in the form of great acharyas, of how they exercise attachment to that which is transcendental, that which is elevating the consciousness, and detachment from that which can be entangling. Anukulyasya sankalpa, pratikulyasya varjanam. Very simply summarized. Now, Rupa Goswami, the same Acharya to whom we attribute these beautiful teachings, in the Charitra Charitamrita Madhya Leela, the chapter 19, this explanation of how Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami were reflecting on their meeting with Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu sometime back in Ramakeli. So Rupa and Sanatan were Dabir Khas and Sakar Malik, basically the left and right hands of the Nawab Hussain Shah, and very capable also. Now Rupa and Sanatan had met Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had attempted to go to Vrindavan through Gaudadesh, and that time they met him at Ramakeli. The meeting with Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was very personal, was filled with lots of affection, and in fact Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu sowed in their heart the desire to unite with him, to be with him all the time. However, because they were in very difficult situation, they waited. They took the instruction of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu that they were his eternal associates. They cultivated the desire, and it's explained.
Dui bhai vishaya tyagera upaya srujila bahudhana diya dui brahmane varila.
So they started devising plans. Upaya. How do we execute the mission of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? They didn't want to just meet Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. just to have nice prasadam. But there was a mission. But even in order to even initiate that mission, there were some hurdles to overcome. They patiently devised plans. And what did they do? The first thing they did is they invited brahmanas so that they could hear Harikatha from them on a daily basis, cultivate the desire to attain the lotus feet of Lord Chaitanya. And then it's explained that Rupa Goswami took his next step. Shri Rupa Gosai Tabe Nauka Te Bhariya. He took a nauka, filled it with what? Apanara Ghare Aila Bahudhana Lana. Large quantities of riches he took in boats, crossed over. And then what did he do? Brahmana Vaishnavadila Tara Arda Dhane Eka Chauti Dhana Dila Kutumba Bharane. So Rupa Goswami divided the wealth into four parts. Eka Chauti. The first part he gave to the Brahmanas and then the Vaishnavas, the first 50%, and then remaining 25% of the remaining 50%, 25% he gave it to his relatives and then kept the remaining 25% for his emergency. And Prabhupada writes, as a practical example of how one should divide his money and retire from household life, 50% of one's money should be distributed to qualified and pure devotees of the Lord, 25% may be given to family members, and 25% may be kept for personal use in case of emergency. So this is a journey, how it begins. And the 1/4 that he had, he kept with the grocer because he knew some emergency can come up. Because a very complicated legal case that he had to fight. Why legal case? Because there was a kind of obligation to the Nawab. The Nawab would not let them free, the absconding from their responsibilities. So Rupa Goswami, meanwhile, was tracing the journey of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He heard that Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had returned to Jagannath Puri and was again preparing to go to Vrindavan through the forest this time. And in fact, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was planning to go to the forest precisely on the advice of Rupa and Sanatan Goswami during his previous visit to Ramakeli. It was very touching. The Lord, listen to their advice. Why are you... You should not be carrying a large entourage and going through public places. If you are going to Vrindavan, go in solitude. So Lord Chaitanya was planning to do that. And in the meantime, Rupa Goswami, while he sought his exit, Sanatan Goswami was reflecting, what do I do? The Nawab is extremely pleased with me. He will not leave me so easily. So he says, now Sanatan Goswami reflects, Konamate Rajya Yadi Mora Khruddha Hoya. If I can make him angry somehow, he becomes angry with me, then he may relieve me. So it's explained that there were two considerations. One is, how will I get released? The second is, Sanatan Goswami was aware that there were many people, the Kayasthas, who were actually looking to replace Sanatan Goswami because they wanted his position. Lobi Kayastha Gana Raja Karya Kare, Apane, Swarge Kare, Shastra Vichare. They were all only thinking about their own well-being. So how do we replace Sanatan Goswami, get him dislodged? So what did Sanatan Goswami do? He said, well, both purposes will be served. Let me remain at home. Let me study scriptures with Vaishnavas and Brahmanas. So this is how Sanatan Goswami didn't get incited by the enviousness of the Kayasthas who were seeking his position. So Sanatan Goswami, he was discussing and studying Srimad Bhagavatam every day. However, the excuse he had supplied to the Nawab was that he wasn't well. So it's explained that this Nawab Hussain Shah, Prabhupada writes in that his name was Hussain Shah, Alauddin Saidia Hussain Shah, Seripa Makkah, and he ruled Bengal for 23 years. So this Nawab, he decided, let me make a surprise visit to the house of Sanatan Goswami. So he went and he saw. Sanatan had said he was not well, but he is listening to Srimad Bhagavatam at home. So Sanatan Goswami then supplied his admission that, King, actually I am no longer able to serve you. Please arrange for someone else to serve you. Now this
outraged the Nawab.
We have made so many arrangements centered around you.
This is unfair. So immediately, you're destroying all my plans. Hence, I immediately order your arrest.
So initially, Sanatana Goswami was arrested. Srila Prabhupada writes in the purport that they had a very nice, cordial relation. So he wasn't very serious in his arrest. But later on, when Sanatana Goswami was proposed by the Nawab Hussain Shah, come with me to attack Orissa. Sanatana said, why should I come with you? You are going to Orissa to attack Lord Jagannath, attack the Lord of the land of Orissa. I will not be able to accompany you. So this time, Sanatana Hussain Shah seriously arrested Sanatana Goswami, put him in prison. Now, Rupa Goswami had anticipated something like this would happen. Therefore, it's explained that Rupa Goswami sent a secret letter.
Eta gaude sanatana ache bandis chale Shri Rupa Goswami ra patri aila hale kale hena kale.
In course of time, Sanatana Goswami received a letter from Rupa Goswami. The content was as follows.
Yadupate kvagata Mathura Puri Ragupate kva gatottara koshala iti vichintya kurushva manasthiram nasadidam jagat ityavadharya.
He said in code language, now this is all code language. Yadupate is Lord Krishna and Mathura Puri. He's saying, where has the Mathura city of Yadupati gone?
Ragupate kva gatottara koshala.
And where has the northern Koshala province of Raghupati, Lord Ram, gone? He said, iti vichintya, reflect on this. Iti vichintya, kurushva manasthiram. Make your mind pacified. Nasat idam jagat. He said, this universe is not eternal. Now this is all code language. The way Sanatana Goswami understood it was as follows. He said, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who is none other than Raghupati and Yadupati, is now on his way to Mathurapuri. Because from the context, it was clear to Sanatana Goswami that the place that Rupa Goswami was aspiring to go to, as also Sanatana Goswami, was Mathurapuri. So he understood from the context. He said, Lord Chaitanya is adventing, is going there. And I am also following him. Because it's a very rare opportunity in life. So reflect on this. So what did Sanatana Goswami do? He reflected. And he went to the jailkeeper. He said, oh jailkeeper, you are a holy jinda peer. Because in this sect, living saints are very rare, and the whole narrative is about how you glorify those who are dead. So someone who is living is considered living as a saint. Very rare. So he said, dear sir, you are a very fortunate person, a living saint. If you release a prisoner, you will get pious credits. Right? And now, Prabhupada writes in the purport that Sanatana Goswami, he spoke words befitting the heart of that jailkeeper. The jailkeeper must have been tired, exhausted, sitting in one place, looking at the same old faces all the time. And somebody speaking such nice words, soothing words, certainly enlivened him. And then Sanatana Goswami, he wanted to seek exit. So what did he say? I have done a lot for you in the past. We had a relation. And he said, I will offer you 5,000 gold coins. Why? Because there was some money left by Rupa Goswami, and he was now putting that to good use. By taking the gold coin and releasing an innocent prisoner, you will accrue a lot of credits. And not only that, you'll also get the best in this world. So the jailkeeper, he said, what you're saying is fine. But if I let you go, I'm a servant, I'm accountable to the Nawab. What do I tell him? Sanatana Goswami says, no, there was no danger. There's no danger. He has gone to the south. It'll take him some time to come. When he comes back, you just narrate to him a story that Sanatana Goswami went to the bank of the Ganges to answer call of nature, and there he jumped into the Ganga and was washed away. I couldn't find him. So the jailkeeper, he was still in two minds. So that time, Sanatana Goswami knew how to
secure his place in the heart of the jailkeeper. He said, Lobo haila yavanera mudra dekhiya, ratre ganga pare koila daduka katiya. So jailkeeper was shown not 5,000, 6,000 gold coins. Here's more for you. And this was enough for him. And he said, please cross over the Ganga in the night. So he left. Now it's explained that Sanatan Goswami left, but the job wasn't done. To reach lotus feet of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he had to cross several hurdles. What was the next hurdle? There weren't expressways at that point of time. And it wasn't easy to book cabs on the press of a button. So he had to walk all the way and walk through unknown paths. There wasn't GPS either to show you the way. You need to talk to people, get guidance. So in the night, he came across a landlord who hosted Sanatan Goswami. But this landlord was very nice in his speech to Sanatan Goswami. Please take nice rest here. You stay here for the day, in the night I'll help you cross over the forest, because they were all completely forest area in the hills. Now Sanatan Goswami, he sensed something is wrong. Why? Because he found that this person is overly sweet in his speech, and that he didn't expect that. Given his past experience, he didn't expect that from a landlord. He was like an innkeeper. So Sanatan Goswami took his bath in the Ganga, cooked prasad himself, and then, sensing that something was wrong, he went to the jailkeeper and said, he went to his servant Ishan and asked him, are we carrying any coins with us? Are you carrying anything with you? And Ishan, he admitted, ye bahu na kene mora sammana korila. Ishan, he knew that so much respect is only possible to someone who has wealth. So Ishan said, yes, indeed, I have some 7 gold coins with me. Now it's interesting, he said 7 gold coins, whereas the innkeeper's palmist had already figured out that Sanatan Goswami had 8 gold coins. So the palmist of the innkeeper had foretold that this person who's here, he actually has 8 gold coins, and therefore the innkeeper was acting sweet because he wanted to plunder Sanatan Goswami in the night. So Sanatan Goswami told Ishan, Shuni Sanatana Tare Korila Bhatsana Sange Kena Aniyache Ye Kala Yama. He said, this is Kala Yama. This is death knell, Yamaraj. Why are you carrying this death knell with us? Because thieves, and even some naive thieves and some sophisticated thieves, all of them will be behind us to seek these gold coins. So immediately Sanatan Goswami went to this innkeeper and told him, please take these 7 coins. Please help us cross the hills. Now the innkeeper, he was actually quite surprised. Sanatan Goswami's sincerity and the gesture he showed so proactively touched his heart, and he said, I'm very satisfied with your behavior. Santushta hoila ami mohara na laiba. I'm happy. I'll not accept these gold coins, but I'll get you across the hilly tract. Now Sanatan Goswami, what argument did he use? Very, very instructive. He said, Gosai kahe keha dravya laibe amamari amara prana raksha kara dravya angikari. If you don't accept these gold coins, what will happen? The gold coins will become a cause of threat to us. So please, prana raksha kori, protect our lives from other thieves. You may release us, but some other thieves may catch us for the same gold coins. They may engage their own palmist. So Sanatan Goswami, on his insistence, finally the settlement was made. Then Sanatan Goswami was told by this innkeeper in the conversation. Innkeeper told him that, actually, I already knew that you have 8 gold coins. So Sanatan Goswami had figured out there's 1 gold coin missing. He told Ishan, Ishan, do you have 1 more gold coin with you? Do you have some more wealth with you? And Ishan admitted, yes, I have 1 gold coin left with me. So Sanatan said, please, Ishan, now you can depart with this 1 gold coin.
In fact, this was the beginning of the journey of Sanatana Goswami, setting the highest benchmark for practicing sadhakas on how to preserve what is required and how to part which is unnecessary, which might become an overhead in due course of time. The journey continued. Sanatana Goswami went to a place called Hajipura. It's in Bihar. It's a famous station there. He went to Hajipur. There he met his brother-in-law, Srikanta, who was the husband of Sanatana Goswami's sister. Now he was trading in horses. He had a lot of vyapar. And he hosted Sanatana Goswami. He said, please stay here. I'll help you cross the Ganga. Please stay here for a few days. Recover. Take rest. Sanatana Goswami said, no. I want to leave immediately. Please just show me the way to cross the Ganga. So Srikanta helped Sanatana Goswami cross the Ganga. But in the process, he also gave Sanatana Goswami a very nice exquisite blanket, which Sanatana Goswami was using to protect himself in the cold. He proceeded, and eventually he reached Varanasi. Now, when he entered the city of Varanasi, he knew that Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was at the house of Chandrasekhar Acharya. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told Chandrasekhar Acharya that there seems to be some Vaishnava at the door. Dwara eka Vaishnava haya bolaha tanhara. Please call him. Chandrasekhar Acharya went out. Vaishnava nahi dware. No Vaishnava there. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, is there anyone at all? Yes, there is a Muslim mendicant. So, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, bring him immediately inside. So, Sanatana Goswami, interestingly, he was dressed as a Dharavesha. Dharavesha is a Muslim mendicant. While departing, he had assured the jailkeeper that with the opportunity you have given me, I will go to Makkah. I'm dressed as a Dharavesha mendicant. And that's what assured the jailkeeper also, because he was doing something very holy. So therefore, he was dressed as a Dharavesh, a mendicant. Only Chaitanya Mahaprabhu could identify him. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu embraced Sanatana Goswami the moment he saw him. Sanatana Goswami kept on insisting, please, O Lord, don't touch me, I'm impure. However, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, simply by your touch, simply by your glance, I'm actually getting purified. So don't deprive me of this opportunity to embrace me. The two great personalities, the Lord and his devotee, embraced each other and shed torrents of tears. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told Sanatana Goswami, Krishna saved you from Maharaurava, from very difficult situation. Why? Because you were actually serving, you were in a completely misplaced situation. Your constitutional position is actually carrying this great tradition of recovering the Vaishnava literature. So Sanatana Goswami, in response, told, oh Lord, you are saying Krishna delivered me from Maharaurava, but I don't know anyone but you. As far as I am concerned, I have been released from prison only by your mercy. This conversation continued. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told Chandrasekhar, please get Sanatana Goswami nicely dressed up. Let him come after bathing, after a shave. And please also offer him new clothes. Chandrasekhar very promptly arranged for the bathing and shaving of Sanatana Goswami, offered him clothes. Sanatana Goswami said no. He didn't accept the clothes. Later on, there was an invitation to the house of Tapan Mishra for Prasadam, where Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went and Sanatana Goswami also went later on. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told Tapan Mishra, please also invite Sanatana Goswami for Prasadam. However, Sanatana Goswami had requested Tapan Mishra that I will not honor Prasadam with the Lord. You give me remnants afterwards. So Tapan Mishra said that Sanatana Goswami has excused himself for something very important. He will take Prasadam later on. So when Sanatana Goswami took Prasadam later on, Tapan Mishra offered him some nice clothes. Sanatana Goswami again told him, no, if you have some used torn quilt, please give that to me. I'll be satisfied with that. And then Tapan Mishra gave him a used torn quilt which Sanatana Goswami tore into many pieces to use. Thereafter, Sanatana Goswami noticed something interesting, that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was constantly looking at him
staring at the expensive woolen blanket that was given to him by Srikanta. So it's explained that, in fact, Sanatana Goswami, he said, Sanatena Vairagya Prabhura Ananda Apar, Bhota Kambala Pane Prabhu Chahe Barabar. Again and again he was saying this Bhota Kambal on the body of Sanatana Goswami. What did Sanatana Goswami do? He said, oh, this is not causing pleasure to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He went to the bank of the Ganges, found a traveling mendicant who had come there with his own torn quilt. And Sanatana Goswami traded his exquisite woolen blanket with the torn quilt, much to the surprise of the traveling mendicant. He said, are you really sure you want to do this deal? Sanatana Goswami said, yes, I am sure. So it's explained that when Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu observed, Sanatana Goswami had given up his woolen blanket and was wearing some torn quilt. He asked, what happened? Sanatana Goswami said, oh Lord, this is how I traded it off. And this was to the pleasure of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, it doesn't make sense to do Madhukari. Now it's interesting. There was a Maharashtrian Brahmin who had invited Sanatana Goswami for prasadam every day. Sanatana Goswami had declined. He said, no, I will only do Madhukari. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, on one hand, doing Madhukari, and on the other hand, wearing that blanket was not setting the right standards. So we can see the benchmarks that are set by devotees, by great acharyas, using every opportunity to illustrate, demonstrate anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya varjanam. This is a constant process of cultivation. It doesn't happen all of a sudden. In fact, if one tries to practice this all of a sudden, it only culminates in markata vairagya. So therefore, it's explained that Narad Muni, he says that Daan is a very profound concept where one cultivates Daan in his life as a daily routine. Whether it is Nitya Karma, whether it's Naimittika Karma, or whether it's Apad Dharma, somehow or the other cultivating the habit of giving, parting away with things. In a conversation between Narad Muni and there's a big king called Maharaj Dharmavan. Narad Muni says that there are two hetu for dhan, anything that we part away. There are two hetu. What are they? One is strength, shakti, and the other is shraddha, faith with which we give, and the other is shakti. So one obviously should give according to one's capacity. And one should give in a way that doesn't drain his capacity. Because the process of giving should not become the cause for grudging. And Krishna explains this very clearly in Bhagavad Gita, where he talks about the three forms of dan. In the 17th chapter, Krishna says that charity in the mode of goodness, dātavyam iti yad dānam dīyate anupakārine, deshe kālecha pātrecha, tad dānam sātvikam smritam. You give because it is part of your swadharma. It is, you are inculcating this habit. It's because you feel, I am fortunate by giving. Diyate anupakarine, and one is not expecting, one is not grudging about what one has given. Therefore, shakti and shraddha, Narad Muni explains, these are the two hetu, or the two foundational elements of dan. And we see this illustrated in the pastime of Bali Maharaj. On one hand, we find Lord Vamandev, who comes to Bali Maharaj, asks for 3 steps of land. That's all. And Bali Maharaj says, please ask for more. Vamandev sets the highest standard of one who receives. Okay? So Narad Muni says that there are actually 7 essential elements of dan: the data, the person who is receiving, the transaction of giving and receiving, the object for donation, the right place, the right time, and the right procedure. Krishna talks about some of these elements in this verse, where he refers to sattvika dan, deshe kale cha patre cha, right person. That in one sense also distinguishes dan from CSR, right? Corporate social responsibility, as they say. Because in dan, you give to the right candidate person, but then you don't keep checking, what are you doing with the money I gave you? No, you trust that person. That's different. That's the difference between Daan and CSR. At least one difference, maybe many more. So it's explained that the candidate is so important. Now, what was Vamandev? Vamandev set another benchmark for one who receives. When Bali Maharaj tries to tempt Vamandev, please ask for more. What have you asked for? You're a small boy. So Vamandev had spoken verses glorifying the entire ancestral lineage of Bali Maharaj. You're about Prahlad, about Virochan, and their Daan, how Virochan gave up his own life to Indra and the Devatas in the process of Daan. And what to speak of Prahlad Maharaj's benevolence. However, Vamandev says, Yavanto Vishyan Vishya Preshtam Trilokana Jitendriya. Nashaknuvanti te sarve pratipuraitam rupa. O King, even the entirety of the entire creation, Yavanto Vishayaha. All the Vishaya Vastu in the entire creation, if it's offered, the Triloka cannot satisfy one's senses if he is not satisfied in himself. In the Mahabharata, there's a detailed conversation between Yudhishthir Maharaj and Bhishma, where Bhishma says, here are 16 people whom you should not give Daan. Right? And it's very interesting. So if someone claims he's a Brahmana, he should just look at those 16 qualities. It's quite scary. What Yudhishthir Maharaj is told by Bhishma, these 16 qualities doesn't make entitled to receive Daan. So Lord Vamadeva sets a benchmark. He's absolutely satisfied with just 3 steps. Of course, because he's a Supreme Lord, his 3 steps are all pervasive. So we see the first aspect of how one qualification of one who receives. Lord Vamadeva sets a standard. And then the subsequent verses, Shukracharya wants Bali Maharaj. Are you sure you want to give? In fact, he gives several analogies to appeal to Bali Maharaj's intelligence. He says that if charity endangers one's livelihood, that charity is not praiseworthy. And he gives an analogy. He said that a tree should be capable of giving shade to others and being beneficial to others for a long time. And the tree should not facilitate circumstance by which its roots are itself cut. Now, ordinarily speaking, Srila Prabhupada writes in the purport. And in the purport, actually, Srila Prabhupada again refers to Rupa Goswami's detachment. Prabhupada says, the Shastras enjoin that if one has money, one should divide all that into 5 divisions. For dharma, artha, for yasha, said dharmaya, yashasya arthe, arthaya, kamaya, swajanaya cha, panchada, five parts. Yasha, for artha, for kama, and one part to maintain his family members. And Prabhupada says, at the present, however, because people are bereft of all knowledge, they spend all their money for the satisfaction of their family. Srila Rupa Goswami taught us by his own example, by using 50% of his accumulated wealth for Krishna, 25% for his own self, and 25% for the members of his family. One's main purpose should be to advance in Krishna consciousness. This will include dharma, artha, and kama. However, because one's family members expect some profit, one should also satisfy them by giving them a portion of one's accumulated wealth. This is a Shastric injunction. So what Shukracharya advised to Bali Maharaj in that very testing situation isn't really countered by Prabhupada or any of the Acharyas. That one element of Daan is Shakti. You must be powerful enough to give Daan. However, what seemed to be missing in the analysis of Shukracharya is the person who is asking for the Daan. That's Lord Vishnu. And therefore, Bali Maharaj, after offering to Lord Vamandev 2 steps, covering everything that he possesses, and the 3rd step as himself, letting the Lord place his lotus feet on his head, Bali Maharaj exhibits this element of Shraddha, that the Supreme Lord, if he takes everything away also, it's for the ultimate benefit of oneself and everyone else. He's not only thinking about himself. Like Radha Gopinath Prabhu was giving a very beautiful analogy on Narasingha Chaturdashi. He's saying, sometimes the Lord orchestrates some Herculean task through devotees, and he was giving this analogy of a big rock. Sometimes you want to move a big rock with an iron rod. Now the rod by itself cannot move, but you need a fulcrum, a pivot. So you place a pivot which is in the form of a small rock. Now that small rock, what is its desirable characteristic? It should be hard. It should be cooperating with that big rod. It should not be wobbly. So sometimes to get rid of anarthas in this world, either personified anarthas or in the form of qualities which are all pervasive, the Lord, in the form of the rod, pivots himself on personalities like Prahlad Maharaj and Bali Maharaj, who don't shake even the most testing situations, who don't give up, who don't crumble, who stay steady and cooperate. So this is the first aspect of Daan, which is about Hetu. Narad Muni says, the second, there are six Adhishtans, or six reasons why someone may give Daan. What are the six reasons? He says that the most sublime reason is Dharma. In the Bhagavad Gita also Krishna says that nature of a Kshatriya, Kshatriya Dharma is Daan. But actually speaking, according to scriptures, Daan Dharma is very natural for individuals in this age of Kali. And it's something that should be capitalized upon, giving. In fact, that is the only Dharma remaining in this age of Kali. In a conversation between Srila Vyasadeva and Shukdev Goswami in the Mahabharata, this point is brought out. So, the purpose for one which gives Daan, the purpose for which one which parts from his wealth, something that he considers very, very dear to himself, that purpose, the first is ultimate good. Ultimate good for oneself and for the entire world. And ultimately pleasing the Supreme Personality of Godhead. There are also other considerations or adhishtans. The second is artha. I'll get something back. Kaam. I'll get my desires fulfilled. Lajja. Sometimes a person may give just because it's embarrassing not to give. What will people around me narrate, right, of my behavior? And then one may give out of harsha because he's very happy. Of course, all these elements coexist in the process of giving. It's not exclusive, but the foundation is recommended to be dharma. The most unfortunate situation is when you give out of bhaya. That's the sixth adhishtan. And we see in this story of hawk that the hawk ultimately gave because of fear. It parted with the meat. So while it is something, it's better to give than not to give, yet it's good to cultivate a scientific aspect of giving. And therefore we find the entire Vedic culture was to cultivate the habit of parting and giving every day. Whether it is putting rangoli outside one's house, because when you put rangoli, you'll find that ants come and eat. There's a purpose that rangolis serve. Of course, today we have plastic rangolis, which ants don't know what to do with. And in fact, the more we have plastic, the more it is difficult to cultivate this the spirit of detachment. Because we don't see anything perishing around us. How will we prepare ourselves for the ultimate test when we have to part with grace, not with grudge? Because the mood of grudgingly giving away, whether while living or at the time of death, is either in the mode of passion or in the mode of ignorance, according to Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita itself. Krishna says that process of giving, which is filled with grudging, which is filled with ahankar, that I am giving, that is in the mode of passion. And then it's explained that why it's important to understand that Daan is a dharma which is for well-being of oneself and others. If you have water in a well, if you keep that water stagnating, in Panchatantra it said that such a stagnant water will make the water of the well useless. The more people draw well from the water, the more water gets recharged and the more the water becomes potable. The analogy is given. One is water stagnating. On the other hand, if you let water flow in a river as against stop it, again the water gets purified along the way. On the other hand, a bee which saves all its honey in a beehive for a long, long time, eventually is only disappointed when it finds that somebody else has taken away all the honey. So therefore, it's explained that in the scriptures, there are many, many examples. And Srila Prabhupada, he writes a beautiful purport in the Srimad Bhagavatam first canto 12th chapter. In the first canto 12th chapter, verse number 20, the qualities of Prahlad Maharaj, qualities of Parikshit Maharaj are eulogized. Esha data sharanyascha yatahi aushinara shibaha. Shibihi. Now, just like Aushinara, the king of Aushinara province, Shibi, was always giving protection to anyone who took shelter of him, this Parikshit will be like him. He will be another Shibi. This is a quality of Parikshit Maharaj. And Srila Prabhupada writes beautiful purport where he talks, refers to two episodes in Mahabharata of Shibi, his tendency to give. So, Prabhupada refers to the first one, which is there. And interestingly, both these stories are narrated by Markandeya Rishi to the Pandavas in the forest, in the Varamparva. When Markandeya Rishi saw the Pandavas, he was smiling in the forest. The Pandavas were astonished because no other Rishi who met them in the forest smiled at them. And Yudhishthira Maharaj asked Markandeya Rishi, why are you smiling at us? I mean, are you rejoicing to see us in this Vanavas? And Markandeya Rishi said, no. When I see you, I remember Lord Ram. And because of that, I want to remind you that everything that comes has to go. And therefore, if you learn to part with grace, then you become glorious and the process of giving becomes glorious. And he gives these two examples of Shibi Maharaj. How Shibi, Narad and Shibi were once going to the celestial planets. Prabhupada refers to this pastime. And on their way, there were four brothers with Shibi. Shibi and three other brothers. So, the four brothers asked Narad Muni, who amongst us will come back earliest from the heavenly planets? So then, he says, Narad Muni says, this king Ashtaka, one of you, he'll be the first to come back. Why? Because every time he gives, he keeps telling others how much he gave. The second he will come back will be Pratardhan. What is his nature? He said, he gave his four horses to four different people who needed it. But after giving his four horses away, he was criticizing those who came asking for those horses. The third brother, he said, was Vasumana. He will be the next to come back. He will stay for longer time. Why? I myself went to him. I saw he had a beautiful ratha, pushpa ratha. And I liked it. I just appreciated it. I didn't ask for it, but he himself gave it to me. Second visit, I again appreciated our Pushparatha. He had a beautiful chariot. Again, he gave it to me. The third time, I glorified his horse. He said, Narad Muni, I know you are asking for it. You are glorifying it because you want it. So no respect for the person who is whom you are giving daan to. But the Shibi Maharaj, Prabhupada says, writes in the purport, the Shibi Maharaj, that amazing sacrifice. A Brahmana had come to him asking for some daan. He asked that you have to give the sacrifice of your son before I accept daan. In front of Shivi Maharaj's eyes, the entire palace burnt. All that he tolerated. Not just tolerated, he withstood. And eventually, this Brahmana, he told Shivi Maharaj, now whatever you have wanted to offer to me and as prasad in charity, you honor it yourself. This is the glory of Shivi Maharaj. And Narad Muni praises, saying that therefore, Shibi Maharaj, he was not evaluating, judging as he was giving the daan. Most natural for him that, in fact, Narad Muni says, I will come back before Shibi Maharaj comes back. And then Prabhupada also narrates the other interesting story of Shibi Maharaj, how a pigeon came taking shelter of Shibi Maharaj. A pigeon was being chased by a hawk. The hawk wanted to eat up. Shibi Maharaj said, I am the king. Pigeon has asked my shelter. Hawk demanded, no, but I also need my share of meat. Shibi Maharaj tried offering alternatives. Nothing worked out. Finally offered his own flesh from his body. And of course, the two were actually divine personalities. Varundev himself had, Agnidev himself had come as the pigeon and Indradev had come as a hawk. So in this way, Markandeya Rishi enlightens the Pandavas while they were in the forest on the importance of giving. Can you imagine? And then, we read in the Srimad Bhagavatam the glories of King Rantidev, how he was fasting for 48 days. And after that, as I was all about to honor Prasadam, first a Brahmana came. I'm hungry. Rantidev shared Prasadam with the Brahmana, then with his relatives. He was about to eat. Then a Shudra came, shared with the Shudra. And then remaining Prasad again, he divided. And that time, a Chandala came. In fact, there was actually no prasad left. There was only water left when the chandala came. And he was about to drink the water. Chandala was thirsty. He parted with the water. And all these personalities came back. Now, Rantidev offers some very beautiful prayer in this process of giving. What is his consciousness? As he is giving to the chandala the remaining water. Na kamayeham gatimishwara param astraddhi yuktam apunarbhavam va Artim prapadye khila deha bhajam antastito yena bhavat yadbukaha. He says that, O Lord, I pray to you not for the 8 mystic perfections, not for salvation from repeated birth and death. I only want to stay among the living entities and suffer distresses on their behalf. Artim prapadye khila deha bhajam. These are all dehi. We are all having embodied beings. They are having a lot of suffering. And Prabhupada there in the purport refers to another glorious personality, Vasudev. Vasudev, that who made a similar appeal to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, that I just want to be in this world to so that I can actually incorporate the sufferings of all beings in my life. Now, one cannot blindly imitate such great, as I was referring to as them as benchmarks that these personalities set. But one can certainly follow the guidance of Narad Muni when he says that There may be 6 reasons why one may give daan, and it's good to inculcate a healthy habit of giving. Narad Muni, just to conclude, Narad Muni says there are 6 aspects or angas of giving. There are different, as we were discussing earlier, the person who gives, the person who receives, the object that is being given, the process in which it is being given, as we see in the case of Shibi Maharaj, the warmth with which he was sharing what he had. And then he says there are different grades of giving, sattvic, tamasic, and rajasic. And there are 4 types. In fact, 2 phalas, 2 results of giving, both in this world and in the next. The scriptures say that the process of giving is one of the best security one can get in this world. One can secure, one can be most loved by people by actually sharing. According to Ayurveda, people who suffer from a lot of depression, they are advised, please share. Please inculcate this habit of sharing, because you are into depression just thinking about yourself 24/7. Think about others also. So in this way, Narad Muni enlightens that this process is very practical, very natural, that can be cultivated. It can be nitya, a part of our everyday life. It can be sometimes naimittika, sometimes an emergency situation arises. Sometimes there are personalities who also do daan out of kamya, some desire, and sometimes harsha, out of happiness. How are the, why, for whatever reason one may give, like we saw the example of the hawk in this verse, one tries to emulate the examples of these great personalities mentioned in the scriptures. Try and incorporate lessons from them in their life. How I can feel grateful for sharing. Why? Because I am benefited in that process. Mercy of the Supreme Lord will certainly flow to one who incorporates a speck of dust from the lotus feet of great personalities like King Rantidev, Vasudev Datta, Bali Maharaj, Prahlad Maharaj in their lives. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki. Grantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki. Jai.